We are so grateful to the Boeing Company for, since 2008, they have sponsored this speaker series. They have kept it free to the general public so that we can keep offering the wonderful speakers that come every year. So please join me in a round of applause for the Boeing Company that made this possible. You know, every year we always try to come up with an interesting blend of speakers, and we try to come up with a lot of different topics. Well, I credit today to Jan Briscoe. Where are you, Jan? Wherever she is. Jan was one who saw this book. She is certainly was not a good member, a good board member of the library for years. And she saw this and she said, oh my gosh, wouldn't this be perfect? And so I stalked Susan online and found her and left a pleading message on her voicemail. And obviously I must have sounded pathetic enough that she said yes. So we're so excited. So let me give you a little bit of an introduction into this very impressive lady that we're so excited is here today with her husband, Bill. Susan Shellwer joins the staff of George Washington's Mount Vernon in 2010 and was named the Robert H. Smith Senior Curator in 2014. She has directed the refurnishing and reinterpretations of the mansion's new room, the reinstallation of the greenhouse slave quarters. We had a talk on that a few years ago. I'm not sure if you came to that. And special exhibitions on hoe cakes and hospitality, cooking with Martha Washington. Take Note, George Washington's The Reader, and Gardens and Groves, George Washington's Landscape in Mount Vernon, which was on display through May of this year. Dr. Shellwer holds a PhD in American Studies from Yale University, a master's from the Winterthur Program in Early American Culture at the University of Delaware, and a BA in History from the University of Notre Dame, where she was among the first co-ed graduates. Prior to coming to Mount Vernon, she directed the museum collections at the Connecticut Historical Society and the rare books and manuscripts collections at the Chicago Public Library. She's taught at Villanova, Rutgers, and Virginia Commonwealth Universities and has written and lectured extensively on the Washingtons and Mount Vernon, American decorative and fine arts, material culture, and women's history. Her book on Connecticut needlework, Women, Art, and Family, 1740 to 1840, received the Connecticut Book Prize for nonfiction in 2011. And she was also honored with an invitation to deliver the Oswaldo Rodriguez Roque. No one knows how to say it, and I am no exception. Endowed lecture, the Yale Art Gallery's most distinctive lecture in American art. She has edited landmark volumes on Connecticut Valley furniture, early American tavern signs. Now, is that just not cool? I'm sorry, that's just cool. Western American art, the Alamo, and Mount Vernon's recent volume, The General in the Garden, George Washington's Landscape at Mount Vernon, which is for sale in the back. And she said she will make sure that she can stay to autograph your copy. So with no further ado, help me to welcome Susan Shellwer.
Thank you very much, Nancy. I'm really delighted to be here. Can you all hear me in the back? Okay, if you can't, at some point, raise your hand. Nancy didn't tell you the other piece of the story, that when she called and left the message to say, would I be willing to come and speak at Sotterley, I was like, yes, because Sotterley has been on my list of places that I wanted to come and visit. You can probably tell from hearing me that I'm not from this corner of the country. I'm from the Midwest. Came to Washington about 6 years ago to take the job at Mount Vernon. And while we were working on refurbishing our greenhouse slave quarters, one of our assistant curators came down to Sotterley and worked with someone on your staff on your woven trap mm-hmm. that you have in somewhere. I saw it. In the slave cabin, and used that as a model for one that we have in our quarters at Mount Vernon. And so I knew a little bit about Sotterley, and it was one of the places I'd been wanting to come. But you know how it goes, you know, three kids, two sets of parents, and lots of things going on at work. You don't get around to all the places you want to get to. So Nancy's call was like, yes, I have a definite date. I can go to Sotterley. So I'm really happy to be here. Mount Vernon, for those of you who have been there, is, I think, a really special beautiful landscape. And so I begin with just some pretty pictures here, because that's the way I experienced Mount Vernon's landscape for the first 3 or 4 years that I was there, just walking through it, enjoying it as a beautiful landscape. It all seemed like it was meant to be and had always been there. And I really didn't have an appreciation for how it had been designed, how it had changed over the years, how it had been restored to try and go back to its original appearance. And so in 2014, we mounted an exhibit on the Mount Vernon landscape. And that was really a reason to go back in and study the landscape. I'm not a landscape historian by training. I'm a curator, which means I work with all the old stuff inside the house. But I walk through the gardens now with completely different eyes because I understand them in a different way. And so the book of which you saw at the beginning it really looks at three aspects of the Mount Vernon landscape. It looks at first George Washington's design for the landscape. The second chapter, that chapter was written by one of our assistant curators. The second chapter by our horticulturalist Dean Norton, who some of you may have heard. Looks at the changes to the landscape from the time the Mount Vernon Ladies Association took it over in 1860 up until the present. And the third chapter by our then head archaeologist, Esther White, looks at a 2010 to 2011 project of replanting, redesigning the upper garden, the ornamental garden, based on archaeology. And so today I'm going to really focus on the first and the last parts of that story, George Washington's design and then this recent renovation of the upper garden. So after George Washington's death in 1799, and here you see a drawing of the landscape in 1787 and an aerial view not too long ago. So you can really see how much of the bones of the landscape really survived intact, which is really remarkable. After George Washington's death in 1799, the property was inherited by three generations of Washington's family, beginning with George Washington's nephew, Bushrod Washington, who was a Supreme Court justice. And I really credit those generations of the Washington family for the sort of minimal changes that they made to both the house and the landscape. I think they really respected the fact that it was a historic property and it was already being visited by really lots of people making a pilgrimage. And they really didn't make any changes that couldn't be undone. They didn't make, they put in new wallpaper and they planted things in the upper garden, but they really didn't make changes that couldn't be undone. George Washington's greenhouse burned in 1835, which was a loss. And the upper garden surrounding the greenhouse, really saw some of the most significant changes. After that original greenhouse burned, the Mount Vernon Ladies Association built a new greenhouse in the 1860s that you see here. And Washington's pleasure garden became a commercial cutting garden. And in fact, the proceeds from that cutting garden, as they sold flowers to visitors, was really part of what supported the upkeep of the property in those early years. So it was very important. So again, I'm going to focus primarily on the first and third parts of that story. And the story of the gardens as the landscape as we know them today really begins, of course, with George Washington at the end of the Revolutionary War. And this is a life portrait of George Washington, which has just come into the collection, rediscovered from a collection in England. It is believed to be the life portrait that was painted in the fall of 1783 by Joseph Wright of Philadelphia, as Washington is at his headquarters in Rocky Hill, New Jersey. And if you look at him here, I think you have a sense of the war weariness. And he's waiting for the word of the signing of the Treaty of Paris. He's just really eager to get home, get back to his property, to retire. He was 51 years old. He had already outlived most of the men for several generations in his family. And he wrote his close friend, the Marquis de Lafayette, quote, "At length I become a private citizen on the banks of the Potomac and under the shadow of my own vine and my own fig tree." Of course, a biblical plantation, but I think it really conveys a sense of how much he's longing to get back home and really get his hands in the dirt. On December 23rd, 1783, he resigned his military commission to Congress, sitting in Annapolis, and this was an extraordinary act. Indeed, one for the ages. The typical path, of course, is for triumphant revolutionaries to use military power as a stepping stone to political power, leading all too often from one tyranny to another. Case in point, not too long after this, Napoleon Bonaparte's rise to power from the chaos of the French Revolution. But George Washington did not take that path. He did resign, and George III is said to have remarked when he heard that Washington intended to resign, quote, "If he does that, he will be the greatest man in the world." Others lauded Washington as a modern-day incarnation of Lucius Quinctius Cincinnatus, a 5th century BCE Roman general who was held to be a model of civic virtue and simplicity. Cincinnatus had been called from his farm to defend the Roman Republic. He defeated the enemies and then returned to his farm, relinquishing the reins of power in order to take up those as the plow horse. And Washington himself embraced this classical metaphor, calling Mount Vernon his villa and hanging Joseph Wright's bas-relief in his study. And here you see the epitome of Washington as Cincinnatus. Okay, so you're all waiting for the garden scenes, I know. So he resigned his commission in Annapolis on December 23rd. And on December 24th, he rode hell-bent for leather, as they say, in order to arrive home at Mount Vernon for dinner on Christmas Eve. Now, if you wind back the clock to 1775, when he left eventually for the Continental Congress and then the Continental Army, he had optimistically told Martha he would be home for Christmas. He just didn't say what year. When he arrived, he found much that needed his attention: family matters, plantation management, and commercial affairs. For one thing, he began raising a second family. His wife's two youngest grandchildren, Nellie in the middle here, and George Washington Parke Custis on the far right. He spent much of that first year focused on plantation management. Like Cincinnatus, he quite literally returned to the plow. His first priority was to reestablish the plantation's economic viability, which had suffered much in his absence, as he wrote to a nephew, quote, "I made no money from my estate during the 9 years I was absent from it and brought none home with me." So he launched eagerly into acquiring new agricultural methods and crops and systematically trying them out. He was also very, and this is part of why I began with that political material, he was, at the same time he's doing all the landscape work that I'm going to be talking about, he's very involved in internal improvements that he hopes will benefit the nation. So in September of 1784, and he's age 52 at this point, he travels west to visit his extensive land holdings on the Upper Potomac and the Ohio River Valley. And on the way home from that, he spends 2 weeks exploring uncharted territory between the Ohio, Potomac, and James Rivers, trying to find a feasible water route through to the interior. He's working on efforts to improve river navigation, securing a charter for the Potomac Company from the legislatures of Maryland and Virginia, who weren't any more cooperative then than they tend to be now. So he's got all this going on. You know, he's not a guy, he's really one of the things Washington is not very good at, and he's good at many, many things. He's not very good at retirement. You know, there's a guy who can't sit still. So at the same time he is got all this going on, he launches a major overhaul of Mount Vernon's grounds. And what he does is introduce important elements of English naturalistic landscape design, designs that had been popular in England going back to the second quarter of the 18th century, but hadn't really been too much introduced yet in America. So up until this time, and this is a conjectural drawing, visitors had approached the mansion by way of a long straight roadway. So here, this was the way you approached, between these two big square garden plots, probably walled in. Right before the Revolution, he had torn down all the earlier outbuildings and made this neat, tidy row of outbuildings with the flanking dependencies around this oval circle. Oval circle, well, you know what I mean. But the very geometric plan. Such axial approaches and formal geometric plans were familiar and typical of late colonial plantations in Virginia, such as George Mason's Gunston Hall on the left and Shirley Plantation on the right in the Tidewater. And of course, you have a similar axial plan here leading up to Sotterley. George Washington's new landscape plan replaced this straight central driveway with a broad, flattened expanse of grass. This was the bowling green. These axial garden plots, and then the serpentine walks, bordered by groves of trees. These were ideas he probably acquired during the course of the war. We don't know exactly, you know, we probably from talking to people, maybe from some gardens that he had seen, we don't know exactly. But he had evidently come to recognize that he had an enviable advantage. Mount Vernon's location, and you see it in the red circle there, located on a high bluff overlooking the Potomac River, offered enormous aesthetic potential that had yet to be realized. And that's just what he hoped to do with this new plan. So taking the landscape from being really a very functional, practical landscape to creating pleasure grounds or ornamental gardens for the enjoyment of family and guests. And this represented a quite radical departure. And it required many years to accomplish this redesign. So in the book, our approach is really thematic. And what I wanted to do for this talk is really look at it on sort of a timeline and look at the process by which the landscape develops over the years. So the first step was really the construction of the greenhouse. And we know that the walls of the greenhouse, the brick walls, had been partially erected by August of 1784. So about 6 months after he gets home from the war. And just before he goes out on that Western trip. The greenhouse, and this is a reconstruction. The original greenhouse, as I mentioned, burned. The reconstruction was built in the 1950s based on the archaeological footprint as well as an early 19th century insurance drawing that gave us the image of the facade. So we have really pretty good information about what it looked like. And it's really, in many ways, a much more formal, impressive structure architecturally than the mansion itself, which is this wooden clapboarded building, rusticated to look like stone, that has a certain sort of overgrown farmhouse quality to it, I think. But this is a very formal structure with the three tiers of windows that you can lower the top panes, you can raise the bottom panes. It faces southward, so you get the southern sun coming into it. One of the interesting things is they get in the August of 1784, he writes to Tench Tillman, who's one of his former war aides, to ask him about Tench's cousin, Margaret Tillman Carroll, who had a greenhouse out in Baltimore. And from this letter, it's clear that Washington doesn't really know what he's doing in terms of building this greenhouse, because he writes, "I shall essay the finishing of my greenhouse this fall, but find that neither my own knowledge nor that of any person about me is competent to the business. Shall I for this reason ask the favor of you to give me a short detail of the internal construction of the greenhouse at Mrs. Carroll's? As there is no cover on the walls yet, I can raise them to any height." So imagine he's got the walls sort of part way up, and then it's like, how is this going to work? What are we doing here? So Tench Tillman makes this inquiry and writes back with fairly detailed information. And so as a result, we know from that that it was not just a greenhouse, but a hothouse. It had flues conveying heat from a furnace room on the other side. Now, that was in 1784. We know that the greenhouse was not finished until 1787, while Washington was at the Constitutional Convention. So that's how long it took. But once it was finished, they there cultivated tropical lemons, limes, oranges, other exotic specimens, including North African aloe vera and East Indian sago palm. Washington also experimented with various botanical specimens in a small sheltered plot near the mansion that he called his little garden. And for example, in the summer of 1784, he received some mysterious seeds from China, which had been sent to him sort of third hand. Trade with the U.S. had opened just 2 years earlier. And these seeds were identified only by phonetic spellings of their Chinese names. So again, he didn't really know what he was doing, but he planted them. Unfortunately, they all failed, so we don't know what they were either. Second step was trees. And as our horticulturalist Dean Nelson puts it, George Washington loved trees. This is one of two original tulip poplars that we know were planted in Washington's time. And we don't really think of George Washington as being terribly poetic. Most of his writing is fairly pragmatic. But in 1748, when he was a 16-year-old surveyor in the Shenandoah Valley, he wrote this almost rhapsodic passage, quote, "We went through the most beautiful groves of sugar trees and spent the best part of the day admiring the trees." In August 1776, as commander-in-chief of the Continental Army, he was encamped on Long Island facing the largest projection of seaborne power ever attempted by a European state, some 35,000 men and 600 vessels. So he's anticipating an attack almost any moment. But nonetheless, he takes time to write home to his farm manager at Mount Vernon with very specific instructions for tree plantings that he wants at Mount Vernon. Quote, "I mean to have groves of trees at each end of the dwelling house, at the north end," which is what you're looking at, "of locusts altogether, and that at the south of all the clever kind of trees, especially flowering ones that can be got, such as crabapple, poplar, dogwood, sassafras, laurel, willow." This plan, like the greenhouse, was evidently not actually accomplished for some years until the spring of 1785 when he writes in his diary, quote, "Transplanted in the groves at the ends of the house the following young trees, viz. 9 live oak, 11 yew or hemlock, 10 aspen, 4 magnolia, 2 elm, 2 la papa, 2 lilacs, 3 fringe, of which you see an example here, and 1 swamp berry." The man is so detail-oriented about everything he touches. Between January and June of 1785, in fact, the most frequently mentioned activity in his diary is tree selection. He's literally almost obsessed with it. Now, the forested acres between his 5 cultivated farms served as a nursery to furnish the rich variety of trees he wanted to frame the mansion. So you can see the colored areas are his 5 cultivated farms. At the height of his property, Washington owned 8,000 acres, so basically this whole area around the mansion. So I understand that its height, Sotterley, was about 7,000 acres, so gives you a little bit of a sense of the extent of it. And so all of the uncolored areas in between is this forested, uncultivated area, and he's riding out to select trees, I guess, you know, tying ribbons around them. So on Wednesday, the 12th of January, he wrote, "Mercury at 42 in the morning, 40 at noon, and 38 at night. Morning very fine with but little wind from the southwest. At 10 o'clock, it shifted to the northwest, blew very hard, and turned cold. Rode to my mill swamp and to other places in search of the sort of trees I shall want for my walks, groves, and wildernesses. I found many thriving ash trees of proper size for transplanting and a great abundance of the red bud of all sizes. great abundance of the white thorn, some young crabapple trees and young pine trees, a number of very fine young poplars, locusts, sassafras, and dogwood, some maple trees on high ground, and two or three shrubs in wet ground, which I take to be the fringe tree. In addition to the native specimens that he marked in his own woodland, he requested seeds and seedlings from friends and relations throughout the U.S. Evergreen magnolia and live oak from the south, balm of Gilead tree, white and spruce pine, and hemlock from the north, and quote, any other seeds of trees which are not common in this climate, that is Virginia. So I think what he's really doing is he's creating an American garden. He wants to have specimens from throughout the states in the same way that he's envisioning an American nation, you know, embodied in what he has on his own landscape. On the 19th of January, so a week after he started out looking for trees, he began laying out the serpentine road that would define the pleasure grounds. On the 26th of February, he wrote that he finished laying out my serpentine roads, dug most of the holes where the trees by the side of them are to stand, and planted some of the maple which were dug yesterday and some of the aspen which had been brought here on Wednesday last. So imagine it's January, and they're digging these holes along the serpentine. They're bringing the trees from the forest. Now, when he says dug most of the holes, he probably, of course, doesn't mean that he himself literally dug the holes. He certainly pointed out where he wanted them. He may have demonstrated how to dig them. But most of the work is done by his enslaved workforce. And they are constantly engaged in installing the new design for the Mount Vernon landscape over most of that year. So that in December, he writes, quote, set the people to taking up and planting small pines in the wilderness on the right of the lawn. So again, it's cold weather, a year has gone by, they're still moving trees. Through February and March of that year, enslaved workers transplanted trees and flowering shrubs and also carted pebbles up from the Potomac, up the hill to gravel the new serpentine. So again, a sense of what that slope is like that you're bringing gravel up. Now, in this area, in the east front of the mansion, Washington wrote in August of 1785, began with James and Tom, two of his enslaved workers, to work on my park fencing. Now, what he's talking about there is his deer park. Long a feature of royal and aristocratic estates, he fenced in 18 acres on the east slope, and as if there weren't enough deer around locally, he wrote to England to friends to import English deer. So that by the summer of 1786, he had it stocked with deer. Here's a view down the slope. I do need to go back, Pete, if we can, to the painting. So there in the circle of the painting, you can just see here's the fence for the deer. Here are two little deer you can just barely see on the slope. This is from about 1792. Well, like the Chinese seeds, this endeavor also failed because what happened? The deer jumped over the fence. They ran all over the rest of the estate. Other people hunted them. That was a romantic feature that failed, I think, to allow him, as he hoped, to be, quote, a participator of the tranquility and rural amusements. Their descendants might well be. In the fall of 1785, he began, now we can go forward. There. In the fall of 1785, he began installing the bowling green, writing, began to spade up the lawn in front of the courtyard. And a week later, began to level the ground, which had been spaded up in the lawn fronting the house. So again, this lovely flat area on the west side of the mansion is, of course, totally artificial. This is enslaved labor, spading this up, leveling it, smoothing it, planting it with English grass. Here's the original 18th century stone garden roller that they would have used for that leveling and smoothing. Compressing the ground, smoothing the surface, burying the seeds. In October, he wrote, "The ground being too wet, I employed the laborers who had been leveling the lawn in cleaning and weeding the shrubbery." So that was that fall's project. Now, we are, of course, accustomed to these expanses of grass. But in the 18th century, to have that kind of expanse of grass, and it was even hard to find the lawn grass at that point, and the scything was considered a very skilled job to keep it all trimmed off. He did not allow the sheep onto the bowling green for that job. That was done by scything. This, of course, as I mentioned, was not a solo endeavor. The work on the landscape was done by both hired European gardeners and enslaved gardeners. From 1773 to 1787, he had a man named Philip Bateman who was in charge of the kitchen garden. And then in 1788, he began a search for a new European gardener who he specified, quote, "is to be a complete kitchen gardener with a competent knowledge of flowers and a greenhouse." So this was clearly a specialized, skilled task that he was looking for someone to fill. He found a gardener named Johann Christian Ehlers, who had in fact been trained at the Royal Hanoverian Gardens in Germany, so the ancestral homeland of George III and George II in Germany, which is pretty interesting. His duties likely included giving tours to people who came to visit at Mount Vernon, and he was replaced in 1798 then by an English indentured gardener. But there were also many enslaved gardeners. One that we know about was named George, and he first came to Mount Vernon in the 1770s. We don't, of course, know what George looked like, but have just a silhouette to suggest his presence. He was owned by George Washington's mother, Mary Ball Washington, who lived in Fredericksburg, Virginia, and so he may have had his initial gardening experience working at her property, Kenmore. For a decade, Washington rented him, paying his mother for the use of the young man's labor and skills. When she died in 1789, Mary Ball Washington left her, quote, "Negro boy George" to her eldest son, George, according to her will. While living at Mount Vernon, George had married Sal Twine, a field worker and dower slave at one of Washington's outlying farms, Dogue Run. And this is our reconstruction of a slave cabin on the site. The couple had seven children, and Sal and the children lived at one of the cabins on the outlying farm about 3 miles away from Mansion House Farm, where the father, George, worked as a ditcher and later a gardener and likely lived in the quarters located on either side of the greenhouse. Probably visiting his family, going that 3 mile distance on Sundays and perhaps sometimes at night, as Washington complained sometimes that his enslaved laborers were tired from this night walking to go and visit their families on the outlying farms. In the 1780s, George was likely among those whom Washington directed to create paths, move and level soil, all those jobs we've talked about, building walls, sowing grass, crushing gravel, and transplanting trees. And these are all references that we can trace in Washington's references, his records, to George being assigned to these tasks. For instance, we know from Washington's diary that the week of August 12th, 1798, was a sweltering one at Mount Vernon, and I know you can all appreciate this scene. The mercury of Washington's thermometer flirted with 90 degrees every day. Ominous clouds roiled the sky each afternoon, but fitful rain showers did little to break the heat. Despite the oppressive conditions, business continued as usual among Mount Vernon's enslaved workers, including the three gardeners, George, Harry, and Joseph. Working under the English indentured gardener, William Spence, the three men weeded and planted strawberries, pruned plantings, sowed seeds for spinach and other greens in the kitchen garden, harvested cabbage, and hauled orange trees outside in the ornamental upper garden. After Washington's death in 1799, George became a free man. We don't know what happened to him after that. His wife and family remained enslaved because they belonged to Martha Washington's first husband's estate and were inherited by her four grandchildren and dispensed to various properties in Virginia, the Federal City, and Maryland. But back to the gardens in 1787. By this time, the garden design was well established with those serpentine paths around the framing the bowling green, the garden plots on the north and south sides of the bowling green on the west side of the house, and that deer park on the east. The greenhouse was nearing completion, and George Washington noted that he brought the ditchers to the home house to finish the new root and complete the sunk fence in front of the lawn. So that would be this ha-ha wall there at the west end of the lawn that would keep large livestock off of the lawn. Meanwhile, back on the political front, discontent was mounting with the Articles of Confederation and the federal government's lack of power. In his study, Washington read alarming reports of a paper money crisis and Shays' Rebellion in Massachusetts. His letters conveyed rising concern as he wrote to John Jay, quote, "I do not conceive we can exist long as a nation without having lodged somewhere a power which will pervade the whole Union in an energetic manner." So before the work on the landscape was quite completed, Washington's attention was, shall we say, somewhat distracted again. He spent the spring and summer of 1787 presiding over the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. But of course, the convention was not in session every single day, and so he was able to get in some good visiting time. We know he visited Woodlands, which was the home of William Hamilton on Schuylkill, south of Philadelphia. Hamilton was a wealthy amateur botanist and patron of the arts and was reputed to have really one of the finest greenhouses in the country at the time. He had some 10,000 species of plants, trees, and shrubs. And we know that in the early 1790s, George Washington received from him about 140 plants in 30 species. And the Woodlands still survives. It's in the middle of the Woodlands Cemetery near the University of Pennsylvania campus. And it's really well worth a trip. It's sort of not on the beaten path in Philadelphia, but if you're in the area, it's not too far from Bartram's Gardens, and it's well worth a visit. Washington also visited Bartram's Gardens. On Sunday, June 10th, he rode to see the botanical garden of Mr. Bartram, of which he wrote, "though stored with many curious trees, shrubs, and flowers, was neither large nor laid off with much taste." So he found it lacking in aesthetics, apparently. It was, however, the oldest surviving botanic garden in America and the premier collection of North American plant species, which the Bartrams had collected from throughout the country. And again, we know that later in 1789 and 1792, Washington orders extensive plantings from Bartram's garden. So again, part of that effort to create an American garden. He also ordered a weather vane for Mount Vernon's cupola, providing specific instructions to Philadelphia master carpenter Joseph Rakestraw that he wanted, quote, "a bird with spread wings and an olive branch in his mouth, a traditional symbol of peace." So a very conscious bit of iconography to top off the mansion and really cap his landscape plan. The symbolism being that amidst this very turbulent convention, however the political winds blow, may peace come to Mount Vernon and by extension the country. So by the time the convention completed its work, the weather vane had gone home to Mount Vernon, offering to viewers a vivid expression of his hopes for the new nation. Now, fortuitously, it is right at this moment in August of 1787, while Washington is at the Constitutional Convention, that the estate is visited by a man named Samuel Vaughan, who was an admirer of Washington's, a British merchant, like many gentlemen of the time, very interested in architecture and landscape design and gardening. And he did this wonderful plan. It's not a plan in the sense that it was what was to be created. It was a record of what Washington had already created. And again, you can see the extent to which so much of that landscape has survived. And Washington specifically commented to Vaughan, praised the accuracy of the drawing. His only comment really was that Vaughan had put too many trees here around the West Gate, and that if those trees had been there, it would have blocked the view. But otherwise, he said it was pretty good. So you can see we still have the formal mansion circle. We have these apsidal gardens, the bowling green, the serpentines, the deer park, basically what's missing. Here are the lines of outbuildings. These are the most geometric, perhaps, remaining part of the plan, designed to make these outbuildings, which were, you know, this is where all the messy work got done, the smokehouse, the butchering, the laundry, all the dirty, smelly stuff. But they're very neatly and symmetrically arranged to look like a compact, tidy village. And they're also strategically, you know, you have these groves of trees, so you can't really see those outbuildings from the mansion. Again, the bowling green, the serpentine walk, the two flanking walled gardens, each shaped like somewhat like a Gothic arched window. The upper garden here, which is what becomes the ornamental garden with the greenhouse here. And then the lower garden is the kitchen garden on the south facing slope for the primary production of fruits and vegetables. Just a few elements of the landscape remain to be completed. In the 1790s, Washington had the enslaved workers clear out the timber on this vista leading from the west door of the mansion about a mile out to the west gate, which is where the main road would have brought most travelers in the 18th century. And again, the idea is instead of that straight alley, you have this very picturesque view. There are two ravines here. And so the road kind of dipped down, went through the woods, giving you a glance of the house as you got closer and closer. Now, after George Washington's death, as I mentioned, it passed through three generations. Oh, and here's a view from the time giving you the sense of that picturesque landscape. When the Mount Vernon Ladies Association acquired the property in 1860, perhaps one of the most important decisions that Ann Pamela Cunningham, the founder, made was that many people said, oh, tear down the outbuildings. All you need to worry about keeping is the tomb and the mansion, because that's all anybody's going to care about. Well, fortunately, she rejected that advice. Her goal, as it remains our goal today, was to preserve and restore the property as much as possible to what we believe it looked like in 1799, the year of George Washington's death. And so as a result, we have this wonderful collection of original outbuildings that give a sense of the working plantation, as you have a sense of here with some of your outbuildings surviving. That upper garden in the 19th century, as I mentioned, became an ornamental cutting garden and then became a rose garden. This is called the rose garden, but really you see lots of other flowers here. And by 1985, and many of you may remember seeing it in this iteration, it had become a very fussy, if you will, layout. Oops, can you just go back? It had the boxwood alley leaning up to the greenhouse, creating that straight axial view. Those boxwood did not date to Washington's time. They were from the early 19th century. They had gotten to be about 6 feet tall and really choking that alley. And it had been divided up into something like 31 small beds and 24 paths. Well, the boxwood suffered from boxwood decline, and we were really losing the boxwood. So that provided an opportunity for our archaeologists, who had long been chafing to get into that garden and see what was underneath all of that, to go in and do a major dig. And what they found, remarkably, was evidence of seven different gardens layered one on top of each other. Now, the one, of course, we were most interested in was the one that they could date to that 1799 period. And here you see them digging. You see some of the early holes from early trees. One of the things that was most interesting is those red spots were test trenches that they went down, and they could find gravel paths corresponding exactly to the location of the paths on that plan that we had from 1789. So that told us that we could really rely on that 1789 plan for the orientation of the garden. And what you see is, instead of all of those small beds and lots of paths, you have just these six main beds, three of them really large. And that provided much more acreage for growing things. It's not tied up in those paths. That led to the plants that could be saved being pulled out and the whole upper garden being bulldozed. And I'm here to say this was really traumatic. This happened the fall after I got to Mount Vernon, and you know, I would walk through that garden and it was really lovely, and it was just kind of really heartbreaking. Are we going to lose this when this moment came and the bulldozers came in? But we are committed to accuracy. And so this is how it has been replanted. This is, I think, in 2011 or 12, so fairly early in the replanting. And following 18th century gardening manuals, the recommendation is that the ornamental or pleasure garden is actually only the outer 10 to 12 feet of the beds that are planted with flowers and flowering shrubs. And then the center of those beds is turned over again to your fruit and vegetable production, your productive garden. And the boxwood edging is kept, it's just edging, it's not even a border, it's kept to about, gardening manuals, I understand, recommend 4 to 6 inches. That's a little shorter than we can manage to keep up with, so we're keeping it about 8 to 10 inches, but very low. And so the pleasure garden is actually the border surrounding the vegetable beds. And so I think this is where I'm going to leave you now with the garden, seeing this restoration. If you haven't been to Mount Vernon recently, I hope that you will come and see the new restored upper garden. It really is quite lovely in a very different way than it had been before the restoration, when I think it had become very much a colonial revival garden, that sense of what people were projecting back on the 18th century, what they thought it should look like. The other point that I want to make is that while Washington, again, while he was working on his garden, he's also working on the country and thinking about the country. And so in many ways, his garden is the physical, the homegrown, the at-home expression of what he called his Republican style of living. So please come to Mount Vernon, come and see us, and resample Washington's Republican style of living. Thank you. Now, I know it's very warm in here, perhaps not quite as warm as that sweltering August afternoon that Washington talks about, but I'm happy to try and field any questions that you might have. So the question is, how do we maintain the gardens today? Do we try to do it as much as possible as they did in Washington's time, or do we have a nice little rototiller? And I would say it is a combination. In the historic area, we try to do things as much as possible in an authentic way. However, we do, for instance, have a sprinkler system, which runs after hours. And so we do use a combination of the old and the new. Yes, sir. Yes, the question is, are there any original trees still surviving on the property? And like many properties, we have lost a couple in recent years. We lost a swamp chestnut oak that was on the east lawn. We were concerned about it being sickly, and we actually had it on the plan for removal in a couple of years. And I came in one morning, and I looked at the lawn, and I was like, what's wrong with this picture? You know, there's something missing, and it had just fallen over. And there wasn't even a windstorm or anything. It just fell over. There are two large tulip poplars that border the serpentine on the west lawn that we know were planted during Washington's time. There is a mulberry outside of the upper garden, the north garden, that dates to Washington's time. Those are the three that are in the immediate historic area. We have, we still have 450 acres of ground that was Washington's, and all told, there are about, I think, 15 to 20 trees on that property that date to the 18th century or earlier, including one oak that's up on a ridge that they have done dendrochronology on, and it dates to the 17th century. Although it doesn't look that huge because it's in a location where it's not getting that much water, and so it hasn't grown that tall, but it's protected, so yeah. Was there another one over here? Well, that's always an interesting question. The question is, how much influence did Martha have on all of this? It's really hard because we know more about Martha than most 18th century women, but she always stands in some ways by her own choice in George Washington's shadow. Her marriage to Martha clearly brought in the money and the manpower that supported much of their lifestyle for the rest of their marriage. So I think that it is safe to say she had more influence than we perhaps see in the records coming down. With the stuff in the house, I can be more specific about what influence she had in some of the choices about furnishing the house. The landscape design does seem to have been mostly George Washington's purview. The kitchen garden was clearly her domain, and in terms of managing the kitchen garden and the food that's being produced, I think we clearly can identify that as being her realm. But about the rest of the landscape, not too much evidence on that point. Sorry. The question was, is there evidence of Washington sharing information, seeds, etc., with Thomas Jefferson? And I don't really know of that much. He's clearly sharing information a lot with friends in Philadelphia. Samuel Vaughan, who I mentioned, the Englishman, they meet for the Philadelphia Society for Promoting Agriculture. Washington is in touch with Samuel Powell. He's corresponding with William Hamilton about his gardens. You have to take into account when Jefferson is in France. And I think he's in France much of the time that Washington is working on the landscape at Mount Vernon. And then he comes back, and then, of course, they have a terrible falling out during the second administration. So I don't really know of much of anything back and forth with Jefferson. Yes, ma'am. The question is, did Washington spend as much time on his agriculture and his farms as he did with his ornamental landscape? And the answer is way, way more time spent on the farms and agriculture. He was really, really interested in agricultural reform. Washington shifts his production from tobacco to wheat in the mid-1760s, which is really early for that to happen. He's very interested in crop rotation, manuring. He builds a dung repository. He's in touch with English agricultural reformers. He buys agricultural books. His people often say that, and this actually comes from Thomas Jefferson and John Adams very early on, they kind of sniff and say, well, you know, Washington wasn't really that educated and he didn't really read those books in his library. Because I think they never really got over the fact that they were much better educated, and yet he was lionized to an extent that they were not. But he had many agricultural books, and he never wrote, there are only about six of his books that he wrote in the margins of, which is one reason why people have said he never read them. He did take notes on a lot of his readings, and in the Library of Congress, there are 800 or 900 pages of notes that he took on his various readings, and over 700 of those pages are on agriculture. And so he has pages like labeled barley or peas, and he will write extracts from what different authors say about that particular crop. He was very interested in innovative plows, but he was concerned that many of his slaves were, according to him, many of his slaves were resistant to learning these new techniques. They had their way of doing things, and they didn't see the benefit, not surprisingly, from introducing the new techniques he wanted to do. So really, the ornamental landscape is just a small piece of what he's doing. I don't know as much about the agriculture, but there are a couple scholars working on it right now. Yes, ma'am. The question is, did his interest in the horticulture lead to his opening his own distillery and brewery? Maybe tangentially. He wanted to bring in a farm manager from Scotland because he thought the climate was similar and the Scots were very efficient, and he hadn't had too much luck with his German gardener who had a tendency to drink too much, and so he was going to bring in a farm manager from Scotland. His name was James Anderson. Anderson got here and said, you know, you're raising all of this rye, you know, you would be much more efficient to take that grain, instead of trying to ship it as grain, convert it into whiskey, and I can tell you how to do that. And so it takes some convincing, but in 1797 or so, they opened the distillery, and in 1798, it produces something like 100,000 gallons of rye whiskey. It is the largest known producing distillery in the country for that year. So I would say his interest was really mostly economic. He could make a better profit from turning it into whiskey. Oh, interesting. The question is, did he try to start trees from trees that were deteriorating? Do we now? Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, if a tree comes down, anything we can recycle it. If a tree comes down, we take the wood and we make things from it, which you can buy in the shop. But yes, we are planting from trees that are deteriorating. Absolutely. There was a large pecan tree at the south end of the mansion, which many of you may remember seeing, that was planted in 1870 or so. Like the trees that Nancy mentioned that you had come down from near the end of the Sotterley mansion, we were very concerned about that tree because it was only maybe, 20 feet from the mansion. And our current board president, when she came in, it had been debated for years, you know, should we take it down? Should we keep it? When she came into office, she said, that tree is not coming down on the mansion in my watch. Take it down. And when they did, they found it was really in quite bad shape internally. But there have been cuttings taken from that and from other trees on the property. And there was one last hand. The question is, did Washington turn a profit from his labors on the farm? Yes, Washington's enterprise was profitable. Jefferson, as many of you know, died hugely in debt. Washington stayed profitable. He was he was an incredible micromanager. He made his farm managers turn in weekly reports of what jobs were being done, how many man days were being spent. These reports look like modern day spreadsheets. I mean, he is crunching the numbers. So he was very diversified. He was really conscious of the economics. He didn't turn a huge profit, because the land's not very good. You know, I grew up in Illinois, and I look at the land we have at Mount Vernon, and it's like, what are you kidding me, you know? so it was hard. But he did, you know, by, you know, just really sheer force of character, I think, managed to turn a profit. Okay, I think you should all get up and move around, and we'll turn the fans on, and thank you very much for your attention.